Thanks so much for joining us for today's message. We're always encouraged to know that God is using this ministry to touch lives all across the world through what He is doing right here in Murphysboro, Illinois. So if you have a story to share, please send us an email at info@cccmurphy.com. We trust that you will be blessed by this message.
If you have your Bibles, I want you to go with me to the book of 2 Kings. And I'm going to be reading from 2 Kings, the 16th chapter, in verse 2. It says, Ahaz was 20 years old when he became king, and he reigned 16 years in Jerusalem. And he did not do, everybody say, he did not do what was right in the sight of the Lord his God as his father David had done. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word because it's life. We're asking you to have your way, God. Speak to our hearts, Father. God, give us ears that don't just hear, God, but a heart that responds. And we'll give you the praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to speak to you for just a little while this morning on activate the blast. Would you turn and look at your neighbor and say that with me? Just look at him and say, it's time to activate the blast. Let me share with you a little bit about what's happening, what's going on here. Ahaz is the king of Judah. And the Bible said that he didn't do what was right in the sight of God. Not only did he not, you know, when we don't do what's right in the sight of God, it doesn't just affect us. It affects everybody around us. How many of you know what I mean? If you've ever been looking for a parking place in Walmart and somebody cuts in front of you, to take that place, they did not do what was right in the sight of God, right? I mean, that's how we feel. What they did, you know, they cut you off and it affected not just them, but it affected you. Here is what Ahaz does. Ahaz ends up taking one of his sons and offering him as a burnt sacrifice to an idol called Moloch. Think about that. This is reality. This isn't fairy tale. This happened. Offered him as a burnt sacrifice. You see, what happens is each one of us have what I call a personal zone, a special place with God. Everybody say, it's my special place. It's a place where we meet God. It's a place that we step into the realm of God, and we begin to pray and seek the Lord. How many of you have got a place like that? Wave your hand if you got. You understand what I'm talking about? There's a place where you meet God. And sometimes it's not so much about a physical location as it is a zone that you get into. Everybody say, I'm in my zone now. You hear them talk about it, you know, in sports, you know, they'll talk about, oh, he's really in the zone today. He's really, what they're saying is he's really got it together. He's in that spot. He's got his focus. And I can assure you that if we get our focus off God, it'll end up on everything else. So Ahaz makes the mistake of taking an entire nation away from the presence of God because he's not experiencing the presence of God for himself. Everybody say, pray. Prayer is a key. Prayer is what brings me into the zone. Prayer is not a gripe session. Prayer is not a weak need, last act of desperation to try and get some help. Prayer is a relationship. It's communicating. It's talking with God. It's building your zone. And Ahaz gets so distracted from his zone that he's offering his children as burnt sacrifices. Not only does he do that, but he does something else. Instead of, see, the more our focus is away from God, the less we depend on him. The more we look to other sources for our answers and for our hope. And so Ahaz finds himself between a rock and a hard place. He's got the king of Syria and Israel coming after him. And instead of looking to God, he begins to look to men. Have you ever seen someone that every time something desperate happens to them, they're calling you? You've become their source instead of him.
Amen.
You have to learn how to trust him. Everybody say, I'm going to got to walk it out with him. But Ahaz doesn't even think about that. Why? Because he's lost this place. He's lost his zone. He's not talking to God. He's not standing in that place where he can touch God or he can feel God touch him. He stepped out of it. He's given up that zone. And he calls to the king of Assyria. And he takes all the treasures of the house of God and sends to him and says, come and help me. You know, it's amazing the treasures that we sacrifice when we quit looking to God and we start looking to other sources. Let me reminisce with you for just a second. I was a young man about a week ago, and I was about 20 years old, I guess 19. I guess 19 years old, and I had an account. Everybody say an account, and that account was because I didn't have any money. So I had an account at a gas station, and he would let me charge gas, and I would pay him once a month. Unfortunately, how many of you have ever had a month that kept on going long after the finances had ended? Anybody ever been there? I had one of those months hit, and I was uptown, and he looked at me, and he said, hey, he said, when are you going to come by and pay your bill? And I looked at him, and I said, I'll be there Saturday. Now, that was either an act of faith or an act of stupidity, because I didn't have a dime, and I didn't have one coming in. You know, it was still going to be a while before I got a paycheck, and I told him, I said, I'll be there Saturday. So I keep trying to, you know, I'm thinking, how can I make this work? How can I get this together? How can, and I came this close to calling my mom. And something stopped me. And I said, no, you know what? God, I'm going to trust you. Well, I'm sure God heard that. But apparently it was on a long distance line. Because he didn't answer me immediately. I mean, I prayed that, you know, and I'm trusting you, God. But man, I'm a man of faith. Monday, I was a man of faith. Tuesday, I'm a man of faith. Wednesday, I'm a man of faith. Thursday, I'm getting nervous. Friday, my knees are beginning to shake a little bit. Come Saturday morning, what's up, God? What's up? I'm a man of faith here, and honest to goodness, man, I told him I'll pay you Saturday, and he closed like at 2 or 3 in the afternoon, and I'm thinking, God, I gave my word, I'm trusting you, I need my zone. So everybody turn around, look at your neighbor and say, find your happy place. I just, you know, because sometimes when stuff is going on, this isn't such a happy place, is it? It's because there is a pull on us to take us out of that place where we meet him. There's a pull on us to try and do it ourselves, to respond in any other way. And I thought, God, I said I was going to trust you. Now it's too late to call mom, because even if I call mom, I can't get the money. And time's clicking by. And all of a sudden, my mother-in-law came by. Well, no, I wasn't married yet. My soon-to-be mother-in-law came by, and she said, hey, there was your old landlord? I said, yeah. I said, I met her in town, and I thought, great, now she wants something from me too. She said, you moved out before you used up all your rent for the month, And so here's a refund. Friend, I'm not sure that's ever happened anyplace else in the earth. But that day it happened. A landlord gave me money because I moved out early. Come on, man, that's God. Put your head, that's God. And it did something for my faith. It cost me. I got that money and I walked up to that station. I paid that guy. I was so glad he could see me. I was hiding up to that point. I didn't want him to see me. I was trying to make sure I didn't go by his place that day. But I walked in and there was, it did something for me. You see, those tight places, they're not made to destroy us. They're made to build us. And it did something for me, but Ahaz doesn't go here. He stepped out of this zone and he's out searching. He takes all the treasure that he had had in the house of God and he puts it into the hand of an enemy and said, come help me. So the king of Assyria, everybody say Assyria, because that's going to play an important part later in the story, comes and he attacks, so they back off of Ahaz, and so he finds reprieve for a moment. Everybody say, a moment doesn't last long. Sometimes we give up treasure for a moment that doesn't last long. And he goes, and after the Assyria came in, the king, you know, came in, broke that enemy off of him. Then Ahaz goes over to Assyria. He goes to Damascus. Everybody say, just hanging out in Damascus. And while he's there, something happens. See, this king Assyria, he doesn't believe in Judah's God. He doesn't acknowledge the God of Abraham. Matter of fact, this rascal's worshiping a false god. And Ahaz goes to where he's at, and he sees this altar that the king of Assyria had built up and had made to the god he served. And Ahaz starts walking around it and going, ooh, that I like that. That looks good. Everybody say, that's a nice altar. Everybody say, "It." Can I borrow that bag? Is that your bag? So she just grabbed your bag without asking you, right? Anything in here? No, I'm zipping it up. I don't want anything to fall out. And so he gets that altar. You know, it's kind of like a woman with a purse. Ooh, I got to have that. He gets a hold of that altar and he said, man, and he starts making a sketch of it and he prints the sketch out and he comes back and he sends a messenger back to Judah and he says, I want one of those. Any of you ever had a kid that did that? I want one of those. I want that. And that's what Ahaz is acting like, a kid. He said, give me one of those. And so he goes back and they have built that altar that looks just like the one in Damascus. And this is what the king of Judah says. Now you take that altar, you take that, let me see your purse. You take that old altar out of there. You get rid of the take that brazen altar. Everybody say, that's pretty brazen. That take that old brazen altar out of there, the Lord's altar. What do you want me to do with it? Throw it away? Now listen to what he said. No, don't throw it away. Just set it off in a corner. Put that one in there. So he allows the enemy to have a place that had been reserved for God. And he gives glory. He's giving God's glory to another. Listen to what he does. He said, all the burnt sacrifices we're going to make on this new altar, we're going to dance around this altar. All the sacrifices, all the blood offerings, everything that is symbolic of any glory, we're going to do right here on this altar. So what about this other one? He said, well, set that one in a corner. Because if I ever need an answer, or if I'm ever facing a situation that I need some direction in, I don't want to get rid of that. Do you understand? There's something in our heart that keeps pointing us to God. There's something inside of us that keeps telling us, this is where your answer's at. It may not be as fancy, it may not be as popular as that, but right here is where you're going to get your answer. Right here is where you're going to discover what life is about. I'm going to tell you that we got too many folks doing this number. Praise God. I'm going to knock your head off. They're wearing two. There's so many. It's like schizophrenia. Hi. What are you doing? You know what I'm talking? It's a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde syndrome going on. You can't serve two masters. Because you're either going to hate one, and yeah, I did that right. You're going to hate one and despise. You've got to find your zone. Everybody say, get in the zone. And I'm not talking about auto zone either. Get in the zone. Get in the place where you can touch God and you let God touch you. Amen. Protect that zone. All of a sudden, what happened is Ahaz gave place for the enemy. Everybody say the enemy. And the enemy slipped into his zone. What you need to understand is once the enemy gets in your zone, he don't want to let you back in it. Easy. Once the enemy, and all of a sudden, well, I need to get an answer here. Call 911, would you? I've got to get an answer. I need to find, and we've let the enemy in the zone. Everybody say he's in the zone. Then all of a sudden something happened. There's a guy by the name, well, Ahaz dies, and his son comes to the throne. And the Bible said this about his son. He said there was nobody before him or after him that ever held on to God the way he did. Oh, you need to hear what I'm saying. He said, this guy got a hold of something. And I thought to myself, why? Why is his son holding on to God like nobody else before him or after him? It might be because he watched his brother burn on an altar to an unknown or to a false god. It might be because he longs for what he's heard about, a God that brings peace and prosperity and hope and understanding into your heart. He never known that. He never seen that. And he decided, I'm going after it. And Hezekiah's first act is he starts cleaning up. Go ahead, go out. Sit down. Don't take that off. All of a sudden, he starts cleaning up everything out of the altar. Now remember, his daddy, everybody say his daddy. His daddy didn't give up completely, right? His daddy kept that altar around just in case I need it. What are you saying? Oh, we've got some cute prayers. We just, you know, we're not going to get real serious. It's just, well, praise the Lord. Just, you know, and so we get real religious with what we got. Everybody say, ooh, that's a pretty prayer. So we're more concerned about style than we are substance. We're more concerned about what I look like. Is my hair in place? My tie straight? That don't ever happen, does it? And so he just, you know, you got to be careful because your relationship can become meaningless. Going to church can just begin to be like a little frolic in the park. That felt so good. I just love the Lord. And we dance around. Can I tell you that if that's what living for God was about, I'd never done it. There had to be a reality. There had to be a substance. I'm not coming to church just so I can, you know, feel better about myself. I'm not coming to church just so I can, give me high five. It's hugs, handshakes, and high fives. I love greeting everybody, but what I'm telling you is there's more to God than just something shallow, than just a bubble that can be popped. None of those bubbles are around now. They're all lost. They're gone. We don't even know where they went. They just disappeared in front of us. Why? Because there was no substance to them. And we get other folks, you know, they get excited for a moment. You know what I'm talking about? It's like, woohoo, do you feel that? Oh, praise God. But it didn't take long. Did you feel, I'm so sorry. You know what I'm talking about? They're walking around trying to deal with an enemy with a squirt gun. There's not enough in them to do any kind of battle. You're going to be out of water before he gets within 100 yards of you. Amen. What are you saying? There's got to be something more. Everybody say more. How many of you had squirt gun fights when you were a kid? Raise your hand. How many of you hated this kind of squirt gun? I hated it, man. I didn't. Why? Because I knew my fight was over in quick. It was going to be over in a hurry. I was going to run out. I had to be real sparingly. Honest to goodness, man. You can't stand your ground. You just, you know, take a shot and run. Just, you know, did I get him? Because you know that what you're dealing with, what you're holding, isn't enough to withstand the enemy you're facing. Amen. Hezekiah comes to the throne. He gets rid of that altar from Damascus, and he brings back the altar of God. He cuts ties to Assyria. He said, you're not welcome in my place anymore. He cuts ties. He pushes him out. He said, I'm not letting you in here. He starts taking down all the idols and the shrines and cutting down groves of trees where they had worshiped false gods. And he brings Israel to God in a way like they had never seen God before.
Amen.
Everybody say, and then trouble comes. Because if you think the devil is going to let you make a clean break, you're sadly mistaken. If you think, would you come back with your altar? I mean, with your purse? Yeah, just walk up here a second. If you think that you're going to give that back and them let you do it, they're going to be following you around, trying to hang that around your neck. That's your clue. They're going to be trying to get it on your arm. They're going to be trying, no, I don't want this. It looks so good on you. No, I don't want this anymore. So hear me. When you start to make a break from your old lifestyle, from your old friends, you can rest assured they're going to be after you. Oh, no, don't you remember the good time we had together? Don't you remember what it was like? You've got to make up your mind. That's not who I am. I'm not going to let you put that on me again. So the king of Assyria shows up. Everybody say, the devil showed up. How many of you got any devils in your neighborhood? No, how many, you know what I'm talking about. All of a sudden, the enemy shows up, camps around, says, come, he Listen, they showed up and they got back. They said, we're going to get you a place again. Get in there. Thank you. Said, we're going to keep you out of this place. Push me. We're not letting you back in. We got you out once. We're going to keep you out. And so there's a struggle going on. And you say, well, what are you supposed to do? Well, let's take a look at Scripture. Just hang there. Look at, everybody say, he almost found it. It was here. David makes a statement. I'm going to paraphrase it, okay? He says, we need to, he said, I'm going to draw joy. Everybody say joy. I got it. With joy. Y'all act like you don't even know who joy is. Everybody say, with joy. Say it again. With joy, I'm going to draw. I'm happy now. With joy, I'm going to draw waters from the well of salvation. You're never going to defeat your enemy when you're operating on bubbles. You're never going to defeat your enemy when you're always down and out. Do you understand? For David, in his life, Trace's life, oftentimes nothing had changed, but his attitude did. He made up his mind, the devil's pushed me as far as it's going to go, and I'm not going to let it go any further. And so he draws joy. Everybody say, I got some joy up in here. Now, the scripture said that when the king surrounded Judah, they didn't know what to do. They come and they start railing against him. Let me paraphrase. All the people are standing around the wall and they start saying, hey, don't let Hezekiah talk you into trusting in his God. Well, he ripped down all this God's altars. He ripped down false altars. He said, you think your God's going to deliver you out of my hand? He said, what God of any nation has ever been able to save their people out of my hand? What makes your God any different than that? And Hezekiah doesn't respond. He told the people, keep your mouth shut because it doesn't do any good to argue with your enemy. So what he does is he just says, he sends word to Isaiah. Everybody say, I need a man of God. You need some relationships with people that you know him. Right. I said you need some relationship with people that you know him. And so he sent to Isaiah and he said, tell Isaiah to pray for us because we're ready to give birth, but we got no strength. What's he saying? I'm trusting God, but I feel like I'm about to falter. I've got great expectation, but I don't know if I can deliver. I've got my mind and my eyes on him, but the clouds are starting to roll in. Then the king of Assyria sent a letter to him and put it in writing so he could see it every day. The enemy will try and intimidate you. He's not just going to say something to you and walk away. He wants to put something in front of your face that every time you wake up, you're looking at it. Amen. That's why Goliath kept going out day after day after day. It's all they saw. And Hezekiah went back to that place. He went into the house of God. In the midst of the presence of his enemy. And he laid that letter before God. And he said, God, I know they haven't been able. None of the gods of all the other nations have delivered. He said, but it's because they're not gods at all. They were just wood and stone made by man's hand. But you, Lord, show them who you are. They haven't said this against me. They've said it against you. Hear God's response. Everybody say, God knows how to respond. I love this. God, now listen to what it says. The Bible said, this is what the Bible said. The Lord answers him and says, since you've prayed. See, some of us want the answer, but we're not willing to pray. Some of us want the breakthrough, but we're not willing to push through. Some of us want to see the walls come down, but we won't march around them. The Lord said to him, since you've prayed against the king of Syria, since you've brought this problem to me, let me tell you what I'm getting ready to do to him. I'm going to bless. Oh, I'm not done. What are you talking about? You should have never volunteered. I'm going to tell you right now that when God says, I'm going to give you a breakthrough, you're getting ready to experience your breakthrough. So what God does, are you ready? No, don't go any. Oh, good idea. Anything else you'd like to take off right now? You got a phone in your pocket? Help him out, mama. Here she comes, the altar of Damascus. God said, let me tell you what, I'm getting ready. He said, I'm getting ready to send a blast. Everybody say, activate the blast. How do you activate the blast? You activate it through prayer. You activate, he said, man, who's that rascal think he is? He said, I'm getting ready. I'm going to blast him. Everybody say, I'm going to blast him. I'm fixing to blast him right now. He said, not only is he not going to march into this city, he's not even going to be able to shoot an arrow against it. He said, I'm going to send a blast into camp. Everybody say, blast. So that night, king of Syria thinks everything's all right. He doesn't know what's getting ready to hit him. And that night the Bible said that God sent an angel into that camp. And when he sent the angel into that camp, that angel anticipation's a killer, isn't it? He sent an angel into that camp, and that angel went through that camp and went, guess who's here? Can I tell you, when the angel got through walking on that camp, that the Bible said that there were 185,000 dead on the ground. Somebody shout it out. It's time to blast the enemy. It's time to activate it, and you activate it with prayer. Thank you. I hope I see you here next week. You have to activate the blast. Doesn't just happen. You have to pray. Everybody say pray. I know everybody's going to walk out of here and say, our pastor is so mean. I'm not doing anything to anybody that I haven't had done to me before. Sometimes living for God gets messy. We experienced that just a minute ago. Praise and worship team. Can I tell you that life is going to deal you unexpected trouble, that you're going to have things happen that you weren't expecting. They just come out of nowhere. What would have happened if the praise and worship team would have went, well, if this is the way it's going to be, I'm just not going to sing here anymore, and walked off, and everybody walked off. I can tell you what would have happened. They'd never been back up on that stage again. What are you talking about? Because we don't have time to mess around. These folks hung out because they knew he was going to show up. Then all of a sudden, a voice from the back spoke from the top. Did you hear that voice? I did. You missed it. Well, they were. Did you hear it when you were up here? All of a sudden, when you were wrestling with that squeak and squall and all that, God sent a messenger from the top. I said that to say this. God doesn't abandon you. He does not walk off and leave you in a mess you're in. He just says, let's do it again, boys. Let's take it from the top. Hezekiah's dad had messed up. Ahaz had lost that special place, that zone. And Hezekiah said, I'm getting it back. I'm not going to let the devil keep what God promised me. Everybody say, he's almost done. The word blast that's found there in Kings, everybody say blast. It means a wind like a violent breath. You think you're the only one that doesn't like what you're going through? You think God sits back and smiles at you when you're wrestling with your dilemma? Look at them. God is ready to answer your prayer, but he needs you to get in that zone with him. Sometimes you got to pull down strongholds. Sometimes the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to pulling down strongholds and casting down imagination. God's waiting for somebody to get in that zone with him and say, here I am, God, and I'm not coming out till I hear from heaven. Here I am, God, and can I tell you, when God said it's enough, all of a sudden there is a wind. And exhale. Have you ever been through something and went, I'm glad that's over. I'm glad that's gone. Can you imagine what it's like when God exhales? How many of you ever watched that cartoon called Peter Ponimus? I can tell you all have really been around. You don't remember, wave your hand if you remember. And there used to be a cartoon called Peter Ponimus. He was a hippopotamus. And he traveled around in an air balloon. It's really rough when I have to explain things. He traveled around in an air balloon, and he would get in trouble, and they go, oh no, what are we gonna do? What are we gonna do? And all of a sudden, Peter, this hippopotamus, would go, and he'd take a real deep breath in, and when he would exhale, buddy, he'd send that balloon shooting across the sky like a rocket ship. Can I tell you that God can show up in a moment and get you where you need to be? When God exhales against the enemy, he's going to cause them to scatter. Say, well, that's all Old Testament theology. Well, let me give you some New Testament in here. Remember when Peter and John are at a gate called Beautiful and this guy gets healed? Everybody said he's healed. In a moment of rejoicing, this guy's praising God, going into the temple, leaping and dancing and carrying on. And he's so excited. Everybody say, I'm so excited. And then all of a sudden, that moment of victory seemingly turns into a disaster. They come out and grab Peter and John and arrest them. Said, what do you think you're doing out here? Who do you think you are? You better know who you are. I'm a child of a king. You're messing with a king's kid. I am not Rick McNeely. I may be Rick McNeely on my birth certificate, but if you were to look on my heavenly name, you'd find out that my last name has got Jesus written all over it. Because I identify with him. They grab him and they take him. They say, you do that again, we're going to throw you in prison. And they wanted to, but they couldn't. Everybody say, the devil would like to. But he can't. Even with Job. Do you remember Job's story? The devil said, that God said, have you considered my servant Job? And the devil looks at God and said, well, man, I can't get to him. Take that hedge down. Let me get to him. The devil's always trying to get to you. But God keeps him at a distance. And so the next time you're going through something that you think you can't handle, you need to remember that God's already determined you're big enough, bad enough, rough enough, and got stuff enough to get through it, or you wouldn't be in it, because he promised he wouldn't put more on us than we can bear. Quit looking to yourself for the answer. Quit looking to others for the answer, and find your happy place. Find that zone with God. So they threaten him, and they tell him, man, don't you do this again. We'll rip you up one side and down another. They go out, and they go to meet with the others. And say, oh, we got arrested today. No, they didn't do that. They went in there, and they had a prayer meeting. Everybody said they prayed. I wished I hadn't messed up my blaster. They prayed. In a minute, you're going to wish I hadn't messed up my blaster. They prayed. And when they prayed, the Bible said that as they prayed, all of a sudden, isn't it amazing? It doesn't take much to get your attention. All of a sudden, the earth started to shake where they were at. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking a prayer that activates the blast. I'm talking about praying until you feel heaven move. I'm talking about praying and you feel the blast. Peter later is arrested. But he'd had an experience in the zone. And all of a sudden, as he's praying, everybody say pray right now. As he's praying, an angel shows up and gets him out of the mess he's in. You're not going to get out of the mess you're in unless you've learned how to give the mess to him before you get in it.
Amen.
Everybody say the zone. Paul and Silas arrested, thrown in jail. When they go into jail, guess what happens? The Bible said they prayed. Everybody say they started praying. That's not exactly what you think about doing. Well, you might pray before you get there. When you get there, that prayer meeting, let me tell you how most prayer meetings end up when you wind up in jail. Oh, God, get me out of here. How come you let this happen to me? How many of us have been a prisoner of our circumstance, a prisoner of our situation, and that becomes our prayer? That doesn't move God. God's moved by faith. Without faith, the Bible said it's impossible to please him. Well, it's so hard to have faith. Really? Walk outside and look up in the sky. He made that. Look at the sun every time I walk out. That's why I love to go to the mountains. I go to the mountains and I look up, and when I honest to goodness, when I get in the Rocky Mountains and I look up, I feel God. Every time I go up there, I go, wow, God, you amaze me. That's just a mountain. How many of you saw Jupiter and Venus this year hooking up? He made those too. Over 640 million miles away. And I saw it. You see, I'm persuaded you can see God if you just look for him. Just look for him. Sometimes we're looking for the wrong thing. They get in there and they start worshiping and praising God, praying. And all of a sudden, guess what happens? The jail starts shaking. Everybody say, the jail started shaking. Now, not only did they feel it shaking, everybody felt it shaking. Everybody say, your pastor is exercising great restraint right now. Do you know how much he wants to move for you? But we gave up our zone. I think it's time we get our zone back. How about you? I said, I think it's time we get our zone back. Let me read this to you. This is in Hebrews 4 and 14 from the Message. Now that we know what we have, I love that. Now that we know what we have, Jesus. Everybody say, we got Jesus. Come on, we got Jesus. Somebody said, well, I got Goliath, but I got Jesus. Well, I got all these demons and I got Jesus. And he came back holding the keys to death, hell, and the grave. There ain't a demon in hell that can intimidate him. Now that we know what we have, Jesus, this great high priest with ready access to God, let's not let it slip through our fingers. We don't have a priest who is out of touch with our reality. Sometimes you go to church and you hear a bunch of religious jargon and you think, well, what's that got to do with my life? Look, God knows exactly where you're at. Jesus is in touch with our reality. He's been through weakness and testing, experienced it all but the sin. What's he saying? He's saying, I've whipped what's trying to whip you. I've already conquered what's trying to conquer you. You need to get in a zone with me. So let's walk right up to him. Look at your neighbor and say, let's walk right up to him. And get what he's so ready to give. Take the mercy, accept the help. Prayer. Everybody say it with me, prayer. P-R-A-Y-E-R. Positive reactor against your enemy's retaliation. Would you stand with me right now? Prayer changes things. God's got what we need. I can't do it. Well, I could get you wet today, but all you do is leave here wet. But he can blast open the wall that's trying to lock you in. He can take out what's trying to take you out. You just got to get in the zone. I love what Paul says in Philippians, the 3rd chapter. He said, I'm trying to apprehend why I was apprehended. What's Paul saying? Paul's saying, man, the last thing on my mind was living for Jesus. But he apprehended me. And I'm trying to figure that out. I'm trying to catch the reason I've been caught. I'm trying to grasp why I've been grabbed. It's because he sees something in you that you can't see in yourself. And he's saying, quit trying to work it out yourself. Get in the zone and activate the blast. I think we ought to just blast the devil out of here. How about you? Come on, raise your hands to heaven with me right now. So this is what I want to do today. If you're in this place and you're going through some stuff, you say, Pastor, look, if I'm going to be honest, I've let some stuff get in my zone because I struggle to touch God the way I really need to touch God. Can anybody relate to that besides me? How many of you, when you get ready to pray, all of a sudden find out you're really sleepy, you're really hungry, or you're really busy? Push the enemy out. Let me tell you how this ought to work. If you start the day with him, you won't have to go looking for him throughout the day. Amen. Well, you don't understand. I get up early. Get up 10 minutes earlier. God ain't deaf. It don't take you 30. You don't have to wake God up to get him to hear your prayer. He's there. He's ready. He said, whosoever will, let him come. Take my yoke on you. My yoke's easy. My burden's light. Trust me. Call on me. Get in the zone. So if you're here and you say, Pastor, I need to get in the zone. And not only do I need to get in the zone, but I need to activate a blast. I got some stuff going on that needs to be blasted out. How many of you right now got someone you'd like to blast? We're going to pray about that. What I'm saying is this. You can't do it. I guarantee you, if I was to grab this bucket and throw it, there would be a lot of people going out of here saying, that's the greatest service I've been in. And others would be going out of here saying, I can't believe that pastor did that to me. Why? What are you saying? I'm saying that when we try and do it, we mess it up. You got to let him do it. So this is what I'm asking you right now. If you're in this place, I want the prayer partners to come down right now. Don't wait. Come down right now. Get positioned. This is what I'm going to ask you to do. If you're in this place and you need prayer, you need God to help you get in your zone and blast some things out. Now, Kristen and Houston are here. I'm not God, but he knows your name. And he can pronounce it. They didn't wait for me to say, okay, come right now. Why? Because, look, the first Sunday they came back, they walked up to me and they said, I've been away too long. Because the devil will try and disconnect you. He tries to get you out of the zone. He tries to disconnect you so he can isolate you. Remember what Goliath did? Send us a man. We don't want the whole army coming down here. Just send me a man to fight. The devil divides and isolates you so he can destroy you. What he didn't realize is I'm not alone. There's somebody that loves me, even though in my own estimation, I've never done anything worthy of that kind of love. But he loves me. He loves you too. So I'm asking you to join them. If you're in here and you've got a situation going on, you need God to touch. You need a blast. You need to get in the zone. I want you to come right now and stand. I'm not going to hold long. I'm going to count to five. By the time, as a matter of fact, let's cut it down to three. It'll save you some time and me some. One, two, three. If you're in this place and you need, just walk down here. Now, I want you to listen to what that scripture I read to you in the message. The King James Version said it this way. Let's come boldly before the throne of grace. What's he saying? He's saying, quit feeling like you don't measure up and you're not good enough and everything's again. What's he saying? He said, God's already walked here. Do you know God knows what, Jesus knows what it's like to have lost not just a friend, but a family member. John the Baptist was his cousin, and they took his head off. And what did Jesus do? Did he throw his hands up and quit and say, well, that's it, I'm not going any? No. He stood in front of a crowd of people, and he said, let me tell you something about John you didn't know. Among all the prophets that were born, there wasn't one greater than John. What was he doing? He was glorifying the life because he understood something. John's life wasn't over. It was just beginning. Can I tell you that no matter where your situation is at, life is not over.
That's right.
It's just beginning. You say, well, you don't understand. I've lost someone I love. Well, you're going to feel some pain, but their life is just beginning. But you don't understand. I got arrested. I got thrown in prison. My own family turned against me, turned me in. Joseph said, they tried to destroy me, but God meant it. They meant it for destruction, but God meant it for my good. How in the world could any good ever come out of this? How many times have we heard that? How many times have we said that? And how many times have we seen God take it, turn it around, and glorify himself right in the middle of it? So this is what I want you to do today. I want you to stretch your hands out. Everybody that's not up here, stretch your hands this way. Hang here with me for a minute. Your chicken won't burn. Stretch your hands out with me right now. Just stretch them out. Now look, when I touch you, I'm agreeing with you. Now if you're, I'm not going to agree if you're griping, if you're complaining, or if it's a pity party. Because if we agree on that, it's going to destroy you. I'm agreeing that God is going to reach in, and in the midst of everything that's going on and everything the devil's trying to do to destroy you, that you're going to get in that zone and God's going to blast you right out of it. He's going to give you what you have need of. Stretch your hands to heaven with me right now. Come on, just raise your hands to heaven. Father, I thank you, Lord, because you're doing it even now.
We worship you.
You've got to shut some things off around you. There are too many things that are pulling on you. God, today, I'm getting in the zone with you. In Jesus' name, I receive it right now. I receive it right now, God. Let them know.
God of the breakthrough.
Father, look at
you
for a second. Scripture said that we're not conformed to this world, but we're transformed by the renewing of our mind. We can't see things through the same prism that the world looks at things through. We have to see them through the eyes of God. Job's wife looked at him and said, "Why don't you curse God and die? Don't you see everything that's happening?" And God looked at her and said, "The Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." What's he say? He said, "I want to trust him. I may not understand what's happening, but I'm going to trust him. Father, in your name, I trust you, Lord." There's so much stuff that pulls on you. Because you have to remember something, Chris. Just when you get saved, that doesn't mean all of a sudden the same day you get saved that everything's transformed. You know, you could be drowning and have, how can I say it? You fall out of a ship and you got a bad habit of cursing, and I save you from drowning, that doesn't mean your cursing habit went away. It means you didn't drown. And now God works on us. Everybody say it with me, work on us. You ready for God to do some work on you? Stretch those hands to heaven. See, this is what I love about God. I'm excited about God because God knows how to work it out. He can get it out of me. He can. Look at me just a second. There's a noise in here. And sometimes, man, it just wells up in a minute. It's like something's getting ready to blow. God's getting ready to diffuse this volcano.
God, I trust you right now. I give it to you.
Just lift your hands right now.
In Jesus'
name. Lord, we just give you praise.
Thank you, Father.
God, for what you've done in this
Thank
house.
You,
God,
Thank
we
you,
lift
Jesus.
You up. We glorify your holy name.
Thank you, God.
God, we speak blessings. I speak blessings over you this day, that his face would shine upon you, that he would give you peace, that your week would be filled with his joy as we begin our day with him. God bless you today as you're released in the name of the Lord. As these continue to pray, God, we stand with them in Jesus' name. You're dismissed.
Thank you, Jesus.
God, we give you peace.